what little moonlight can do. Oh, what little moonlight can do to you. You're in love, your hearts are fluttering all day long. You only stutter 'cause your poor tongue just will not utter the words I love you. Wait a while till a little moonbeam comes peeping through. You'll get bold, you can't resist him, and all you'll say when you have kissed him is, ooh, what a little moonlight can do.
I'm pleased to welcome you to the final installment of our ongoing series, The Humanities in Space, as tonight we look up to the moon. We begin, however, by first glancing below and acknowledging the traditional territory upon which we gather this evening. Long before Europeans arrived, varied and numerous native people sought to walk gently on this land. They offered assistance to the first European travelers to this territory, sharing their knowledge for survival and living a good life. Among others, the Potawatomi, Miami, and Illinois inhabited what is now this part of Chicago. Though we honor the treaties that were signed, we also know that these treaties were brokered under duress. As Potawatomi Chief Matea said at the signing of the 1821 Treaty of Chicago, quote, "This is a small piece of land. If we give it away, what will become of us? The Great Spirit who has provided it for our use allows us to keep it. We would incur his anger if we bartered it away. If we had more land, you would get more. But our land has been wasting away ever since the white people became our neighbors, and we have now hardly enough left to cover the bones of our tribe." In solidarity with Chief Matea, we recognize the history and legacy of this subjugation, as well as the enduring presence today of Native Americans among our faculty, staff, student body, and community. And it's thus that we seek a new relationship with the original peoples of this land, one based on honor and true respect. And now to get us started for real, please join me in welcoming Joe Bruchek, who's going to be speaking later tonight, but to offer a blessing song.
Likewise, in tomba, de Louis se so zapala no ki da ozi, dae salatoria no vison bi, favo de landa atan. Hello, my friends. My name is Joseph, or the Peaceful One. I'm on a place called Saratoga, the area we call the Medicine Spring Place, the Adirondack Mountain region of the Northeast. We are cousins of the Alene, the Potawatomi, and the other Algonquin-speaking people of this land. And so I'm going to offer you a song which comes from the Mi'kmaq people of the New England, northern New England area, a song that gives thanks and recognizes the circles of the sun, the stars, the moon, and all the people, human and animal, plant and stone, who dance in that circle.
Happy day,
so much, Joe. So I'll be back in 15 minutes to introduce our topic as well as our speakers and performers. But to launch this evening, we hope that you enjoy this screening of a 1902 French silent film classic, recently restored after a rare hand-colored print was discovered. And we're going to be playing it tonight with some music. It was never meant to be shown in silence. There are various scores and even scripts of people speaking that would go along with it. But we're going to be playing it with a contemporary score that was created for it just tonight as well. This is George Méliès's A Trip to the Moon. Western world, there are 8 phases of the moon. New moon, new crescent, first quarter, new gibbous, full moon, old gibbous, last quarter, and old crescent. My brief introduction then tonight is going to follow these 8 phases. We begin in the dark of a new moon, in the darkened theater with Georges Méliès, A Trip to the Moon. And it's fitting to begin with this film, I think, because its complications and ambiguities in many ways parallel the themes that have been running throughout our entire spaced themes series this academic year, celebrating, as we have, the imagination, wonder, and scientific ingenuity that has increased our knowledge of the universe beyond Earth, but also realizing that there are important ethical, political questions that often get ignored, but that must be addressed. A Trip to the Moon is a technological marvel. Its cinematography, special effects, and narrative structure groundbreaking for its time, and influential over the century to come. In movies such as this, the camera was often stationary, fixed to a position as if a spectator in the audience of a theatrical production. But Méliès innovated. The most famous scene in the film, the rocket landing in the eye of the moon, is one in which we see from the perspective of the travelers to the moon, rather than the member of an audience. That is, we see the moon getting closer and closer to us as if we were one of the scientists on board the rocket. This is thematically important, too, for multiple reasons. Note, for instance, that the landing on the moon is presented twice in this film. First, that fantastical scene of the moon with a face where we're the scientists, and then the timeline rewinds and we see the landing again, as you're seeing here, but in a somewhat more realistic way. And so we have to ask, what meaning is here? Why is the director forcing us to take up the scientist's viewpoint by showing this moment twice? And the answer, I think, has to do with seeing the movie as an anti-colonialist, anti-imperialist work of art. It's clear that this is a satire. The scientists are shown as somewhat buffoonish, but it's also clear that they're kind of horrible people. The moon is harmed by their going there. The moon, personified, is assaulted by humanity's visiting it. And once the scientists arrive, things only get worse. They murder the natives, unprovoked and without any apparent emotion other than joy. They swat at them with their umbrellas and pulverize them, marveling at the wonders of this new world they've discovered while learning how to destroy it at exactly the same time. Later, when the colonizers return home, they bring with them one of those natives, forcing him to dance and entertain the masses, even dragging him along in bondage to be part of the celebration. A celebration that ends with a parade, taking everyone to a grotesque statue of an imperialist scientist stomping on the moon's face a twisted vision of pain, with the lunar rocket stuck in its mangled eye. Here, then, is one of the earliest depictions of our voyage to the moon, at least visually, and it's set clearly within the world of violence and empire building. But, of course, this is not the earliest version of such a story. It's not even the earliest version of this story, since Méliès was heavily influenced by Jules Verne's 1865 novel, From the Earth to the Moon. Here, the scientists are replaced by the United States Baltimore Gun Club. The US Civil War having just ended, these weapons enthusiasts are looking for new adventure and new purposes for their cannons, and so they plan to build the Columbiad space gun to carry them to the moon. It's a scenario that will recur in a slightly different manner a century later when the United States, fresh from World War II, embraces Nazi scientist Wernher von Braun, whose German V-2 rockets were fired more than 3,000 times at civilian targets, mostly in London, but might help us win the space race to the moon if we could just get him to work on rockets that carry humans up rather than explosive payloads down. The violent technologies of the war, angled now toward exploration, one must pause to ask whether it's possible to point the values of those tools anew as well, or if a technology of war, slightly repurposed, will always be a technology of some sort of war. I was born just a few miles from where Neil Armstrong was born. Though our births were separated by nearly 4 decades in time, they were separated by very little space. Growing up, I felt a strange connection to him and would go to the little museum there in Wapak, Ohio, marveling at such things as his boyhood bicycle, his school report cards, his Apollo spacesuit, and a genuine moon rock collected from Neil's 2.5-hour lunar walk in July of 1969. To be honest, though, I could go to the public library far more than I could go to the museum. And there, I read books about the engineers who made the Apollo program happen. I came to idolize those scientists as much as I did the astronauts, especially the Ohio astronauts, who always had the more glamorous position in the public eye. I grew up enthralled by space and space travel, a member of Carl Sagan's Planetary Society as a young man, a celebrator of all things beyond Earth, an amateur astronomer, with crazy dreams that because the same corn and soybean fields that surrounded me had also surrounded Neil Armstrong, perhaps we weren't so different. With crazy dreams that I could be a scientist, a philosopher, perhaps even a space traveler. Armstrong's most famous speech was that business we all know about, the small steps and giant leaps, when he first set foot on the moon. But just as interesting is a speech he made as commander of the Apollo 11 mission while he, Michael Collins, and Buzz Aldrin were traveling back to Earth. On the day before arriving home, still thousands of miles away, Armstrong addressed the world in a TV broadcast, saying, 100 years ago, Jules Verne wrote a book about a voyage to the moon. His spaceship, Columbia, took off from Florida and landed in the Pacific Ocean after completing a trip to the moon. It seems appropriate to us to share with you some reflections of the crew as the modern-day Columbia completes its rendezvous with the planet Earth and the same Pacific Ocean tomorrow. As we saw earlier this year, when we were looking at issues surrounding our future on Mars, when the history from which we draw our narratives is a history of colonialism, empire, capitalism, violence, we must make sure that our small steps and even our giant leaps are thought out carefully. We're not the first to ask such questions, of course. Even while most of the country was marveling at the space program and the truly incredible feat of having reached the moon, there were those who questioned why we were going and why the focus of our spending was on space rather than problems at home. You may know a few songs about the moon. We'll hear some of them tonight, actually, just a few minutes from now. Turns out moon is a word that apparently rhymes with pretty much every other word. But before all that, I thought we might briefly consider two moon songs you likely won't hear more of after this introduction. Chicago native Gil Scott Heron was something like a mixture between John Coltrane and Malcolm X, a spoken word bebop revolutionary whose beatnik poems and songs always forced us to rethink everything about our culture. He was best known, perhaps, for The Revolution Will Not Be Televised. But when he released Whitey on the Moon on that same LP, and just weeks after the Apollo 11 crew had made their historic rendezvous with our natural satellite, he gave voice to a sentiment with which a large part of America that wasn't otherwise being heard agreed.
Nell was Whitey on the moon. Her face and arms began to swell, and Whitey's on the moon. I can't pay no doctor bills, but Whitey's on the moon. 10 years from now, I'll be paying still while Whitey's on the moon.
Now, it's almost surely a false dilemma to say either we fund NASA or we fund social programs. That's not interesting, I think. Where there's a deeper truth is that Scott Heron is getting at something other than just budget decisions. A truth that forces us both to consider what we mean when we say that we chose to go to the moon, and also that we accomplished something by going there. If Armstrong's first sentence while on the moon was, unfortunately, of the times in terms of its sexism, one small step for man, remember, then we have to ask as well, even if we expand it to mean humankind has now reached the moon, who exactly gets counted inside that humankind? Since the Enlightenment, we've had the tendency to think that tools are value neutral, and our technical achievements are similarly abstract and aloof from the politics of our time. Humanity has now been to the moon. But is this even really true? To put the point slightly in a slightly different way, Nobel laureate Bob Dylan once sang, "Man has invented his doom, first step was touching the moon." Now, when Rolling Stone magazine asked him to elaborate on that rather cryptic line, Dylan responded in the following way. He said, I mean, what's the purpose of going to the moon? To me, it doesn't make any sense. Now they're going to put a space station up there, and it's going to cost, what, $600 billion, $700 billion? And who's going to benefit from that? Drug companies who are going to be able to make better drugs. Does that make sense? Is that supposed to be something that a person is supposed to get excited about? Is that progress? I don't think they're going to get better drugs. I think they're going to get more expensive drugs. So if we approach the moon with a bit of skepticism as to the purity of our intentions, let's also remember the history of why we eventually decided to go there. We have discussed at previous events in this series the US-Soviet space race, especially in terms of getting the first satellite, the first animal, the first human into orbit. But we would be remiss if we didn't remember as well that the reason JFK dared to say that we'd be on the moon within a decade, or decade, in his famous speech, was also to beat the Soviets. Starting in 1959, and over the course of 17 years, the Soviet space program Luna sent robotic missions to the moon. Luna 1 missed the mark and ended up orbiting the sun, but Luna 2, in September of 1959, was the first human-constructed object to crash onto the moon. Early in 1966, Luna 9 became the first probe to touch down softly. This was important for showing that a lander wouldn't sink into the lunar dust. It turns out that NASA, too, was crashing probes into the moon before Luna 9 landed. In the 1960s, NASA's Ranger program was sending up unmanned spacecraft with the specific intention of hurtling them at the moon and taking photos throughout the process. Costing about $1.3 billion, adjusted for today, the first six Ranger probes all failed in one way or another. But Ranger 7, 8, and 9, however, all hit their marks and returned images. You're looking at the final moments in the life of probe Ranger 9 as it meets its doom on the surface of the moon. Which brings us to the full moon phase of this introduction, the brightest moment that allows the moon to shine with reflected light and reveal from its perspective what it's gained from our travels there. And unfortunately, the only thing that the moon has gained from this seems to be a bit of a black eye. Méliès was prescient. Not only have we bombarded the lunar surface without mercy, but in our many visits there, we've taken a great deal, samples, dust, rocks, and data. Yet all that we've left behind in its place has unfortunately been a heaping mound of trash. You're looking at a list of all the waste we've abandoned on the moon. More than 413,000 pounds of it. Some things we abandoned when we pulled up stakes and left after various Apollo missions from 11 on, but most of this is stuff that we purposefully crashed. And this rather long list, full of probes, rocket parts, descent stages of landers, satellites, and three different moon buggies, this is only a list of the big stuff. It's the small stuff that's much more telling. That list would then have to include such things as six American flags, Alan Shepard's golf balls, commemorative plaques, pins, jewelry, a gold-plated telescope, a silicon disc with written greetings from 75 world leaders, a photo of astronaut Charlie Duke's family, a piece of lava from Devil's Lake in Oregon, shovels, rakes, boots, hammers, cameras, backpacks, towels, wet wipes, empty food containers, a medal, a golden olive branch, a fraternity application, an urn containing the ashes of planetary geologist Eugene Shoemaker, which is wrapped in brass, etched with five lines of Shakespearean poetry, and 95 bags of astronauts' urine, feces, and vomit. Oh, and art, too. There's actually a museum on the moon. Carried aboard Apollo 12 and designed by Forrest Frosty Myers, the ceramic wafer, which is actually slightly smaller than a postage stamp, contains work of art by six prominent artists of the times. Most people tend to focus on Andy Warhol's penis doodle, which he claimed was just his initials, an A and a W in a stylized juxtaposition, but no. For my money, the single line drawn by Robert Rauschenberg is the star attraction in the Moon Museum. But in many ways, though, this tells the whole story, our very best and our very worst. We take both with us wherever we go. But maybe we shouldn't go everywhere. Maybe. It's one thing to think about the romantic notion of a museum on the moon. It's another to leave our poop behind. The logic, of course, makes perfect sense. Why cart it back? Why use up space and weight and thus fuel on the returned vehicle to bring back something nobody wants? But that's the problem with logic. It does make perfect sense. The logic of colonialism, empire, and subjugation has never been under question. It's the ethics of it all that damns us. The moon's black eye gets erased every 81,000 years. Given its extremely thin atmosphere, tons of space debris, rocks really, hit the surface of the moon without breaking up upon entry. This churns up the dusty surface, mixing up the top inch of moon dust so much that it amounts to a relative complete resurfacing. But the truth of the past is never so easily obscured. The reason that the moon shines so brightly is, of course, that it merely reflects light from the sun. But in reality, it's actually a horrible reflector. It's mostly black. It's just that given how dark the rest of the sky is, even a 3% solar reflecting ability makes you look bright in comparison to the vast emptiness of space. We earthbound animals have looked up to the brilliance of the moon surely as long as we have had eyes to do so. Late in his life, when Albert Einstein was at Princeton's Institute for Advanced Study, he glanced up. Walking through campus with a well-known quantum physicist, Einstein and his friend had been debating the apparent absurdities of some of quantum theory's commitments. According to the Copenhagen interpretation, popular at that time, certain qualities of objects, and perhaps even things themselves, were said not to exist until a measurement was taken on them, until they were observed. Macro objects are made up of these quantum things, of course, and so Einstein famously asked, "Do you really believe that the moon only exists when we're looking at it?" Today, the most agreed upon answer to that question is, the moon is there all of the time, but only probably. When I was young, very young, apart from those scientists and astronauts I idolized, the most important people in my life were my boyhood dog and my great-grandmother. They taught me what it is to love. I hated having to leave my great-grandmother each evening, heading back to a somewhat less than happy home, always worried about being apart from her. She told me to look up at the moon through my bedroom window and remember that she was looking at that exact same moon too, even if we were not in the same place, because there we were together. We were both there with the moon. We were both there on the earth beneath the moon. For me, this is what it came to mean to be here, to be together, to be with the moon. The moon has done so much to help us learn how to love. I wonder if it's not mere sentimentality, but an actual foundation for an ethic to think about that love, to think about our dependence on the moon, to think about how we might learn to tread lightly on the earth and also tread lightly, if at all, on the moon, even when merely looking, because looking can trample, and looking always carries values with it. Ethics is so often a matter of widening the net of inclusion. In the West, it begins with only white, property-owning males having moral standing. Then perhaps white males in general, white women maybe next, then non-white men and women, maybe non-white humans who don't identify as one sex, then maybe animals, perhaps eventually plants. The history of ethics reads like an exclusive country club that little by little gets more progressive and allows a few select others through its doors and over its walls. But perhaps this has been wrong all along. Perhaps accepting the wall is always wrong. Starting the discussion about ethics in exactly the wrong way, because then morality is reduced to debating who gets to be on which side of that wall, and never really debating the wall itself, never really debating the presuppositions of our traditions and our concepts. For the last several years, I've been working, thinking through, trying to do something about an ethic for rocks. Thinking that lifeism is one of the prejudices that perhaps we have to overcome. Can the moon be better or worse off even though it's not alive? Just because it's dry and lifeless, does that mean we have a blank check to do anything we want with it? Can a rock flourish? I was inspired to ask these questions by that moon rock at the Neil Armstrong Museum I saw so often as a child. Perhaps it was the third most important person in my early years. I owe much to it. And yet, we've taken so much from the moon. Maybe it's time to give something back. Perhaps, as hard as it is to imagine, it's time to repatriate some of the moon rocks we've taken, finding a new way to exist together. That word we is always a loaded word. We look up and we see eight phases of the moon, but we have been conditioned by the Enlightenment to think that there are certain truths to the way in which Enlightenment thinkers think. Native Hawaiians, for instance, look up and they see 30 phases. We were going to have a live moon-themed Hawaiian hula and chanting demonstration for you today, but one of the main artists was called away due to a death in her family. Out of respect, we take this time to send our good thoughts to her rather than hold the performance without her. Some things are ambiguous and confusing. I'm still not sure how best to proceed with space exploration in general. Other things are quite simple. We're all in this together. And that we must never be taken for granted or closed up. That we may very well include bodies that are not the bodies we imagined at first to constitute us. Bodies of those whose difference calls on us to rise to the occasion. Ancestral bodies. Bodies of those yet to come. Even planetary bodies. Celestial bodies. And so, the phases of the moon are complete, though that which is cyclic is never truly complete. And as a new moon comes into view again, into view in all its unviewable, dark, unlit glory, I welcome you and thank you once more for being with us here tonight. Now, to begin in earnest, I'm pleased to present our evening's first performance and the first instantiation of the Bach and Beethoven ensemble. The BBE has been our house band all year throughout this series, and we've had some incredible performances thanks to them. And especially thanks to Thomas Alon and Brandy Berry, the executive and artistic directors of the ever-malleable ensemble. To get us started this evening, please join me in welcoming historical keyboardist Charles Metz.
Thank you for being here. I am going to play the first movement of the Beethoven Moonlight Sonata. The great irony of this work is that Beethoven did not name it the Moonlight Sonata, and then when he composed it in about 1800, he, as far as we know, never even thought about the moon. It was a wildly popular piece during his time, and so popular, he was actually annoyed that it was so popular and was known to have said that, certainly, I have written better pieces than this. But it wasn't until after Beethoven died, about 5 years, that a music critic and poet described the first movement as moonlight over Lake Lucerne. And he hit magic with that because within 10 years, all of Europe then knew this piece as the Moonlight Sonata. So really it is a name that was applied to it after Beethoven died, but it's one that has stuck. And I think what's valuable for us tonight, as you hear this, is to be in the ear of the beholder for yourself. And what does this piece conjure for you in terms of the moon? Is it the moonlight on a lake, or it may be something different for you? Thank you.
I hope that you had a chance before you came in tonight to check out the foyer. We have a nice art display and you can play Lunar Lander. We have an amazing oil painting of the moon by DePaul's own Matthew Gearson, some fantastic photographs by Steve Harpin display out there. So I hope you get a chance to enjoy that on your way out as well. I also wanted to let you know that our Barnes & Noble's rep is out there and they're selling copies of books by all three of our speakers tonight, including the one who's up next. Scott O. Montgomery is an independent scholar, geologist, and affiliate faculty member of the University of Washington, Seattle. He's written widely in the history of science and the history of ideas, as well as on topics that combine aspects of the humanities and natural sciences. His book with Dan Chira, The Shape of the New, Four Big Ideas That Built the Modern World, was chosen by the New York Times Book Review as one of the most notable 100 books of 2015. Indeed, Scott's many books are all fascinating reads, but it is especially his fantastic book from nearly 20 years ago, The Moon and the Western Imagination, which is on sale outside, that brings him to our attention tonight. To present his lecture entitled The Lunar Canvas, A Perspective on the Moon in Art, Literature, and Science, I'm very pleased to introduce to you Scott Montgomery.
Well, thank you all for coming tonight. I intend to entertain you a little bit with some art, some pictures. Pictures are always exciting to look at, especially when they're in color and they are very expressive. This is a little bit of an unexpected approach to talking about the moon, but I think you'll find it very relevant. It is something I've been thinking about, writing about, sometimes even publishing about, but it is very unique, as I hope you'll agree once I show it to you. A little bit of background on this. The iconography of the moon, or let me start a little bit larger. Let me start quite large. Einstein said a lot of very cool things, some of which he said and some of which he didn't. but one of the very interesting things he did say is that the mysterious aspect to the universe is its comprehensibility. And that's always struck me as both a scientist and a humanist. It's a very insightful comment. And yet, that comprehensibility is something that we often have to struggle for, that may take many, many years, many centuries. And in a particular case of the moon has a history on the Earth, right? A history of imagination, a history of visualization. And that's what I want to focus on a little bit here today. Focusing mainly on the West, that's what my book was mostly about. And there's a reason for that. But the moon belongs to everyone. It belongs to us. And when I say us, it's with a capital U and a capital S, meaning everybody on Earth. And it always has. It belongs to all of us as humans, and yet it belongs to none of us at the same time, right? I think you'll all agree with that. And yet taking possession of that moon, as Dr. Steves, suggested, is something that we've done in different ways over a long period of time. Christianity took ideas from the Greeks, took ideas from Plato, and much later took ideas from Aristotle. From Plato, it took the idea of an intelligent creator who made the entire universe, partly after his own fashion, but also partly as a work of craft. Plato used the term demiurge, which means master craftsman. Aristotle came into the West, as we might call it, or Europe, much, much later than you might think. Plato was adopted quite early on in the 4th and the 5th centuries by Christian theologists through the philosophy of Neoplatonism. But Aristotle was not conveyed by the Romans to Europe. In fact, Aristotle and his physics and his view of the universe was transferred by Nestorian Christians and Syriac-speaking Christians to the Levant and then to further east as well, and then was taken up in Islam, translated into Arabic, and mixed together with Persian ideas and also with Hindu ideas of the heavens and to a very, very rich scientific literature, which finally made it into Europe through translation into Latin. These are very extensive historically studied epics. They are fascinating. And they will shatter your ideas about the basis for scientific advance in Europe. There is a period called the 12th century Renaissance, which really lasted from the 12th century into the mid 13th century. And that period of time is really when Europe, medieval Europe, inherited this great legacy of knowledge through Islam, through the Arabic language, from the Greeks, because the Greeks' sense of science never passed to the Romans. The Romans had no real use for that, but Islam certainly did. And when Europe inherited that, it took several centuries for them to imbibe it, if you will. And one of the ways they did that is through the university system. That was a brand new institution in the 1100s. It blossomed in the 13th and the 14th centuries. And along with that came reform in the church, St. Francis and his view of nature, that every blade of grass is worthy of observation and a degree of concentration, that every single object of God's creation was worthy of our attention. And this was filtrated into art, particularly in the 13th and the 14th centuries. The interesting thing about it at that point is that, the type of art that was being done was done in prayer books called Books of Hours, which were really prayer manuals for the wealthy. And in the margins of those illuminated, as we say, manuscripts, meaning they were painted in beautiful colors, very, very beautiful colors. In the margins of those were small animals and insects and leaves and fruit, painted with a tremendous and growing, evolving naturalism, something that will seem to us very, very striking when we think about all the depictions of the saints and the crucifixion, all the holy images, which were not very naturalistic at all, but these little creatures that lived around the margins of these prayer books were quite naturalistic. And we see this evolving in a very rich way. In the 15th century is when this expanded through the art of one particular individual to include the entire universe and the entire world, and the heavens as well. Now, just to give you a very brief background on the crucifixion, because that's what we're going to be looking at. I don't want to make this sound maudlin or or anything like that, but the crucifixion was obviously a key iconic image. And in that image, in Western iconography, the sun and the moon were both portrayed as above Christ. That is not how it appears in the New Testament, in the Gospel of Luke and Matthew and Mark. The day became dark. And in Luke, it sounds close to an eclipse. But in the actual paintings, the sun and the moon both are in the sky. And that really reminds us much more of the story of Joshua, and who called upon God to have the sun stand still in the valley of Ajalon so that Joshua and his warriors could defeat the Amorites and take full possession of Israel, which God did. So there's a bit of an interesting mix-up here. But we're going to move ahead and look at Van Eyck's version. This is Jan van Eyck, who lived from about 1380 until about 1440, 1445 perhaps. He never wrote anything outside of his canvases, so we have no real final records of him except his works. And there are only about 24 of those that have been found so far. So this is the crucifixion as he painted it in a diptych, two panels. It is not very large. It is about 22 inches high and about 8 inches across each panel. So it's quite small. It's in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. You can go see it there. You'll have to join the crowd because Van Eyck asks you to press your face close to his images. There's, as you can see here, they are very crowded. They are full of images, they are full of objects, they are full of people, they are full of colors. And they have a foreground and a background that is very distinct. Van Eyck is the inventor, not of oil painting, he was a perfecter of that, but he did, it seems, invent the perspective of the far background growing into the blues, as you can see that. Now we're going to be focusing on the left side of this, the crucifixion, the other side is the Last Judgment. And we'll be moving in a little bit on this. So what I want to point out to you here is something very unique. When we take time to look at all the figures beneath Christ, we see almost a world of people from different regions. We see, let's see if I can point some out to you here. This down here is a Mongolian shield. The sword here is a scimitar. The gentleman here is dressed in and has the mustache of a Turkic warrior. We see the Roman over here, but we also see a gentleman in African armor and the gentleman here with African features. So we see Arabs, we also see Hebrews. What we don't see very much of is Europeans. But we see people throughout Eurasia. Very interesting. This has not happened in any other painting of this early date. Flanders at that time, where Van Eyck came from, Netherlands and Flanders, was a trade nexus for all of Europe. And the 14th century and into the 15th century were a period when Flanders was receiving trade and goods, objects, from all over the world. This was an opening up of Europe, even after the period of the Black Death, which was in the 1340s and 50s. So I wanted to point this out to you. But we're going to look a little bit more closely as well. And I think you can see why at this point, because the moon appears here. Interestingly, we see the moon not in the position where it was in the past, up here associated with the Christ figure, but down here below the cross of one of the thieves. This is very interesting. This is a complete break from the past, from over 1,000 years of iconography. What we also see, if we focus our attention, is that the heads of the two thieves are inclined toward the right. Jesus' head is inclined toward the left. If we look at the moon closely, as we will in a second, it's inclined towards the right like the thieves. So the moon is clearly associated with the thieves. Now why? Why would that make sense? This is where Aristotle comes into the picture. Aristotle had been translated into Latin and become, oh, a mantra of learning, if you want to put it that way. Something everyone had to study. It was very much part of the core curriculum and part of the knowledge of every scholar. And Van Eyck was very, very interested, very urged to appear scholarly. Not only does he have people of many different backgrounds, he also has above Christ's head, here lies Jesus, here is Jesus, King of the Jews, in three different languages. In Hebrew, in Latin, and in Flemish. In other places, he uses Arabic characters and Aramaic characters. So language is a diversity focus in his work as well. Now why, what would Aristotle have to do with this? Aristotle's view of the moon was very different from Plato's. Plato saw it as a perfect sphere. And this was a very common view in a large part of medieval Europe. Aristotle, however, saw it as the boundary between a perfect heaven above and what was called the sublunary realm, where materials could change, transform. They could be corrupted. And this sense of corruption, change, is associated with the thieves here. If you see what I'm saying. Let's look a little bit closer. Now we can see the moon here. This is the very first naturalistic image of the moon in any art anywhere in the world. This is almost 100 years before Leonardo painted or drew the moon in a semi-naturalistic fashion. It may look a little bit like a jack-o'-lantern view, with the Mare Imbrium up here. Oops, excuse me. Well, I won't go through the various Mare here. But you can see that it is associated with the Earth, with the Alpine background, as well as the Thief here. And this is a nice Alpine background, a meandering stream up front. Very different from the foreground, the hill of Golgotha, where Christ was crucified. That was in an arid climate. And this is interesting, these two different things put together like that. So some critics have said, no, this is not naturalistic. This is just a jack-o'-lantern view. But it turns out that when we look at Van Eyck's work, we find five different images of the moon. No painter for hundreds of years painted the moon that many times. Not only that, but in different views. So this is Van Eyck's unfinished version of St. Barbara. And if you look up here in the corner, you can almost make out a crescent moon with Earth shine. Very interesting. Definitely the first image in Western art to show this. And in the other images, he has a gibbous moon. Oh, one other thing I'd like to point out just very briefly, excuse me. One other thing very interesting here is the irregularity of what we call the terminator, the boundary between shadow and reflection. The terminator that became very important for Galileo hundreds of years later when he drew convincing rocky images of the moon and had a major impact on Western views. So Van Eyck was not just making things up. Van Eyck is a very interesting and a very important break with the past. Previous to him, the naturalism, Gothic painting, Gothic art and sculpture was focused on the things of the organic universe. As I said before, leaves and flowers and birds and insects, snails as well, crayfish, lots of little things that you would see in a medieval garden. And of course, those books of hours where these creatures appeared were for wealthy people, many of whom had gardens. And so there was a connection with that. With Van Eyck, the world opens up to the whole inorganic universe. Mountains, rivers, rocks, streams, hills, and the moon. And also, we noticed before, one other thing that I'll go back and show you are the clouds. The sky is full. These are very nicely rendered cumulus clouds. And a gentleman who I know who's a meteorologist said, oh, it's clear, yeah, there's just been a rainstorm and these are clearing clouds after a major rainstorm. And I said, well, that's pretty interesting. But here you have someone who is, in a sense, ultra-naturalistic in what he paints. And I'll show you one other example after we look at a comparison between his moon and Leonardo's. So we only have a half sheet. And Leonardo trying to paint the Maria, kind of drawn out. Perhaps the other sheet would have been very good. But again, it's a notebook. It's not in color. Van Eyck did color it, showed it what it would look like in the late morning hours and where it would appear in the sky. Nothing like that in Leonardo's notebook. One last image that I want to show you, very different. The moon does not appear in here, but something does that has always struck me. And when you take a geologist in front of this painting, they will be dumbstruck, especially when they see the date, because this is clearly a cliff of shale and limestone. And I'll direct your view to the little portions, little white portions in here. These are identifiable fossils, crinoids, brachiopods, mainly. And these are 400 years before geologists had any notion of how to draw a cliff or how to interpret it. Now, how do you explain this? How do we explain this? Van Eyck was not a geologist. In fact, geology didn't exist. What we see is someone who collects precise observations from the natural world and places them in a kind of diorama. You can see here also, despite the detail of the cliff, you can see between the feet of St. Francis, who is receiving the stigmata, and Brother Leo, who's asleep. This is very clumsily done, not convincing at all. And that just adds to our perception that here is a man that spent a great deal of time doing portraits of natural objects and placing them in his paintings, because all of this was God's creation, not just the little birds and the bees, but everything, all of creation, including the moon, was worth as much detail in portraiture as the image of Christ itself. This is very striking, and it gives us a sign of what science would be like later on, the privilege that science would give to observation during the scientific revolution. And I would point today as a very last point to make, that we are doing this right now. Peter sort of sent us into space, but what's happening today is that we are sending robot eyes out into the outer reaches of the solar system. We are taking pictures of all the planets and their moons. We are mapping them. We are naming the features. But the geologists, and it is the geologists' work, is to observe, to see with the naked eye, and to draw pictures of them, and to interpret what they mean. If I were a young man, that would be one of the most exciting fields you could possibly go into it, discovering and exploring new worlds. It's really fascinating to think about. And I do have friends who are leading some of those trips. Steve Squires is one of them. I was in a class with him. The professor was Carl Sagan, who had a very wicked sense of humor, I will tell you. May not notice that when he does Cosmos, but he had quite a wicked sense of humor. So these types of things have never gone away. The value of observation that is just as tantalizing today and just as present in today's science as it was for religious reasons in Van Eyck's time. Thank you.
We're ready for another musical selection from the Bach and Beethoven ensemble. So along with Charles Metz, please join me in welcoming the very talented soprano, Catherine Spitzer.
Good evening. Hello? There we go. Good evening. Thank you so much for coming today. The first piece that Charles and I will be performing together is Vaga Luna by Vincenzo Bellini. Just a little bit of background about what I will be singing. Immediately, the narrator of this piece calls into or identifies the moon, the beauty of the moon, how the moon is shining upon the nature that surrounding it and shining its silver light down upon everything. And throughout the song, he is begging the moon to tell his lover how much he misses her, how much he will never stop loving her, and is asking the moon to relay these messages to her. So again, it's kind of that connection of what we were hearing prior, you know, that the narrator is seeing the same moon, and he knows that his lover is also watching the same moon.
Oh, no.
That's fantastic. The moon can really inspire, can't it? Whew. Our friends, Jeffrey A. Landis is a scientist at the NASA John Glenn Research Center. He was a member of the Mars Pathfinder scientific team and is currently a member of the science team for the Mars Exploration Rovers. He's also a fellow of NASA Innovative Advanced Concepts, where his projects have included designing light sails for interstellar travel, a sail-powered rover for exploring the surface of Venus, and a rocket-propelled hopper to investigate geysers on Neptune's icy moon Triton. He's published 400 scientific papers, and from 2005 to 2006, he was the Ronald E. McNair Visiting Professor of Astronautics at MIT. Jeff is also a Hugo and Nebula Award-winning science fiction writer. He's the author of the novel Mars Crossing and a short story collection, Impact Parameter and Other Quantum Fictions. He was named the recipient of the 2014 Robert A. Heinlein Award, bestowed for outstanding published works in science fiction and technical writings that inspire the human exploration of space. Yet another great mind here this evening with us that thinks beyond the false boundaries among the humanities, arts, and sciences. Here with his presentation entitled Fly Me to the Moon, Spaceflight and Science Fiction, please join me in welcoming Jeffrey Landis.
Talking about science or science fiction, but let's talk about the intersection, science and science fiction together. Science and science fiction have a long history. Spaceflight, in fact, is a history of science fiction that sort of predates both the existence of spaceflight and the existence of science fiction. I really have to point out Kepler, who we mostly know is the father of astronomy. He invented the idea of how planets orbit the sun in elliptical orbits, actually wrote a science fiction novel back in 1634, Somnium. It actually wasn't published until after he died, as actually many of her classic works were. Francis Godwin, Voltaire, who the humanities majors will probably be more familiar with, wrote a satirical science fiction novel, Micromegas, back in 1752. And the early works of science fiction really familiarized humanity with the idea that the planets aren't just dots in the sky. They're not just these pretty things that fly around overhead, but they're actually places that people could, in principle, go to. There were worlds, there were places. In fact, that was the whole point of Somnium, was to give people the idea, well, what would the universe look like if we were on the moon looking up at the Earth among other things in the sky? Voltaire used it as a setting for satire, for sort of poking fun at the foibles of humans and, to some extent, of human institutions. But it brought to the public the idea that these were places. They weren't just dots in the sky. I like this story, actually. Edgar Allan Poe's The Adventures of Hans Pfaall, 1835. I think of this as the first hard science fiction story, or by hard science fiction, I mean a story in which actual science was used to justify going into space. And Hans Pfaall, in this story, went to the moon in a balloon. Well, you'd have to say, well, how can I call that hard science fiction? You can't get to the moon in a balloon. If you think about it, this was 1835, and he made some speculations in science. He said, well, this balloon is filled with a substance that is, I believe, 20 times lighter than hydrogen. You say, well, that's not science. We all know hydrogen is the lowest element on the periodic table. It is the first element. There is nothing lighter than. On the other hand, this was 1835. The periodic table wouldn't be invented for another half century. So we can give Edgar Allan Poe a little bit of credit here. He actually invented a spacesuit for his astronaut to go to the moon in a balloon. It was still rather a tall tale. So most people would call this one, which we've already seen a picture of the French edition of, Jules Verne's From the Earth to the Moon, English edition in 1873. Fascinating story, again, with the Columbiad Canon, as the Baltimore Gun Club saying, well, at the end of the Civil War, we need to sell more gunpowder and weapons. What's wrong with America that we can't have a good war? They said, well, we're going to send a cannon shot to the moon. And there is the Columbiad Cannon that Jules Verne imagined to send a projectile all the way to the moon. And there it is, the little capsule going to the moon, which we saw a little bit later in the French, the very early French version. So there's the capsule in one of the woodcut illustrations on the way to the moon, where he actually describes the zero gravity, the microgravity of the trip. They have a dog with them, and the dog dies. And they say, well, we will throw the dog out because we don't want a dead dog in our capsule on the trip to the moon. So here you see them throwing the dog out. And they say, well, the dog doesn't go away. It just floats along next to the spacecraft. So they marvel about it. I marvel more about the fact that they could open up the door and then close it again. But Verne actually explains this. He says, well, we open up and close the door very, very quickly so the air doesn't get out. Well, okay, that was 1865. What is fascinating is how good Verne picked for many of the things. Here's his launch to the moon with the Columbiad cannon on the left. There's the actual launch to the moon with the Saturn V rocket. And he picked Central Florida as the place to launch from, which for more or less the same reasons was picked by NASA for the moon launches. Close enough to the equator that the moon actually goes over Florida, so you can go into an orbit where the moon goes overhead. So here's actually a comparison from Earth to the Moon, 1865, with the Apollo spacecraft that did the same mission. And from Earth to the Moon, unlike the French movie, they don't land on the moon. The capsule goes around the moon and then returns to the Earth. And the spacecraft that did that was the Apollo spacecraft in 1968, not the famous Apollo 11, but the also quite famous Apollo 8. The capsule was launched by the Columbiad Cannon from Florida in Jules Verne. The capsule was named Columbia, launched from Florida. They both had a crew of three. Jules Verne said, well, we'll make this out of this exotic metal aluminum. The most exotic thing you could think of is the time. It's far lighter than steel, but nearly as strong. And well, guess what? By 100 years later, 1968, they made the spacecraft out of aluminum. Jules Verne guessed 9.7 tons for the spacecraft. He got that a little bit wrong. It was 13 tons and 2.74 meters in diameter. Turned out to be about 3.9. But there's the comparison view of the two, Verne spacecraft and the Apollo spacecraft. Pretty good guess by Jules Verne there. He said they'd splashed down in the Pacific, rescued by the steamship USS Susquehanna. And here's the actual reality from the woodcut, from I think the US edition in the left, and then the actual photograph by the US Hornet recovered in the Pacific. Of course, moving on, it turned out that rockets were a little bit more reasonable way to get to the moon. The one problem with Jules Verne's idea is possibly you could get to the moon, but in doing so, the cannon would squash all of the occupants being shot out of the gun to a very thin jelly at the bottom. That's a problem that Verne sort of hand-waved away. So Robert Goddard patented his liquid-fueled rocket. He wrote in 1920 a report called A Method of Reaching Extreme Altitude, in which he just had, I think, a single paragraph saying, oh, you could get to the moon this way. But the press picked that up. They said, oh, look at this crazy guy. He's talking about going to the moon. And that sort of disturbed Goddard so much that he really never talked to the press again. But did go on, moved out to Albuquerque, probably then moved a little bit further out to start making those much larger rockets. Those rockets, many of which worked, he was really the father of sort of experimental rocketry. But some people who were also very interested in rockets were the Germans. So by this time, science fiction was beginning to be invented. And the great film director Fritz Lang did this movie, Frau im Mond, The Woman in the Moon, premiered in Berlin, 1929, just as the Nazis were thinking about, oh, maybe we should start getting ready to take over first Deutschland and then the world. So here's the landing on the moon from Frau im Mond, 1929 envisioned. A landing on the moon. A pretty good vision. The artists at the time were thinking, well, with no air, the mountains in the background would have absolutely no erosion. They'd be these very sharp, crystalline, defined peaks. Turned out they guessed wrong about that. But there's the scene of the rocket being pulled out of its hangar, on tracks to bring it out to the launch pad. There's the rocket. And so there's the view from reality, the vertical assembly building with the rocket being pulled out also on tracks. So guessed pretty well in that. Fritz Lang actually had a very interesting thing about his movie. He said, well, it's a publicity stunt. Let's actually make a real rocket. But meanwhile, around the same time, the British Interplanetary Society was also trying to look more realistically at what would a rocket look like to go to the moon. And of course, the most famous member that I think of as the British Interplanetary Society of those days was a young student at the time in London, Arthur C. Clarke, who went on to do many other things like inventing the communication satellite and writing 2001 A Space Odyssey. But there's the British Interplanetary Study of what it would take to land on the moon with the rockets of the day, the sort of rockets that were being developed by Robert Goddard. And there's a view, again, of what it would, how it would come down. And they thought out the ideas such as you would need a heat shield, you'd want to come down with a parachute. Meanwhile, I said, Fritz Lang said, I'm going to do a publicity stunt for my rocket. I'm going to get a rocket club in Germany to actually fly a rocket, a real rocket, in order to celebrate my movie just to get publicity. So here is the local German Rocket Club, the VFR, Verein für Raketenflug, making their rocket as a publicity stunt that he funded to do his film. Here's one of their early rockets, the stick rocket. Here's one of their later rockets. If you look in the background, there's that student, Werner von Braun, who was with the VFR. Turns out the publicity stunt was a complete failure. They weren't ready with the rocket. The movie premiered and came and went long before the VFR was ready to demonstrate their rocket. But the Rocket Club went on further, kept making larger, bigger rockets, culminating, of course, with this one, the V2, the Vengeance Weapon 2, used in Tom Lehrer's words, once they go up, who cares where they come down? They actually were used to come down in London because they were carrying warheads of TNT. But again, after the war, many of these rockets were taken to the US. Many of the rocket scientists came with them. They merged with a interesting group of rocket scientists that were already working in America, not Robert Goddard's group, but a different group working out in Pasadena. At the time, they were called GALSET, the Guggenheim Aeronautical Laboratory of California Institute of Technology. But they changed their name to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory a little bit later and collaborated on going beyond the V-2 for some larger rockets. Here's some of the V-2 launches from the US, just testing the liquid propellant technology as they then went on further to make bigger and more powerful rockets, eventually ending up in the rockets going to the moon. Well, these rockets, these V-2 rockets, had a tremendous effect on the images that we saw in science fiction. When you look at the science fiction of those days, it's 1948, you see a lot of rockets that were heavily influenced by the look of the V-2. This is an interstellar craft, and by gosh, it sure looks like a V-2. Here's the rocket ship Galileo, Robert Heinlein. Look at that sort of cigar-shaped body. Destination Moon, the movie made from the Robert Heinlein. Again, a very sleek, streamlined V-2-like rocket. So Destination Moon was really the first realistic attempt at kind of a large-budget science fiction movie that would show what it would realistically look like to land on the moon. There it is. There's the moon rocket, pretty much as Heinlein described it. And again, you see that moon with the very rugged, unerroded landscape that was believed by the artists of the time, saying, oh, with no erosions, it would be very jagged mountain peaks, and the stars would be very bright with no atmosphere. Of course, a lot of other people made very, very V-2 looking rockets. Here we see the cartoons from France, explorers on the moon. I love the little space suit on the dog Snowy, and they even gave him a radio. Meanwhile, with the actual development of rockets, here's the quite famous series in Collier's magazine when von Braun and some of the other team from that era, Willie Ley, von Braun, some of those, tried to show the public we could actually do this. We could go to the moon. This is not Buck Rogers stuff. This is reality. The Buck Rogers stuff is an interesting name that even comes down to today. When I mentioned GALSET, the laboratory at Caltech that was making rockets, at the same time, actually, as the German group in Nazi Germany, and they named their laboratory the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. So here's a question for you. Why did a group working on rockets name their laboratory the Jet Propulsion Rocket instead of the Rocket Propulsion Laboratory? Well, the answer is simple. They said, well, if we named it the Rocket Propulsion Laboratory, people would dismiss us out of hand. They'd say, this is Buck Rogers. So they called it Jet Propulsion Laboratory purely to get credibility with the public. Here's the view from the Colliers trying to get people to say, wow, this is real. And finally, actually, they're getting rid of that streamlining. They finally put it together and said, wait a second, if we're going into space, it doesn't have to be sleek and streamlined. There's no atmosphere we have to cut through. We can just have fuel tanks just sitting out. So there's the Collier's version, the moon lander, late 1950s. And this started to show up now in the science fiction. Some rocket ships that were not sleek and cigar-shaped, but a little bit more adapted to what might be a realistic idea of its flying not through atmosphere. So there's what the spaceship actually looked like, and you can see, yes, it took that idea There is no requirement for streamlining at all. There's the landing stage, there's the takeoff stage, and everything is just rough edges. There's no no attempt at making it that beautiful cigar-shaped rocket that is still actually what I think rockets ought to look like. So here is Arthur C. Clarke's 2001 as envisioned with his collaboration with Stanley Kubrick. And comparing that to the idea of what a lunar base might look like in reality, here's a NASA artist conception of what a moon base would look like. Just some other ways that science fiction has been influencing and having a conversation back and forth with science. Here is the space, the winged space plane from 2001, A Space Odyssey. And this one, of course, does not go to the moon. It goes to and from the Earth. So it is sleek and streamlined. We can compare it to the space shuttle, something that had about the same task, doing the same thing, going into space, rendezvousing with the space station, and landing on wings on the Earth. So there's the space station from 2001, A Space Odyssey. Clarke's idea, going actually quite back, going back to von Braun and before that even to Tsiolkovsky, was the space station would be a big wheel. It would rotate. The rotation gives you centrifugal force, gives you the effect of gravity. Clarke and earlier von Braun said that we might need this because we don't know that humans can live for a long time in space. Of course, the interesting thing is that a lot of the reason you go to space is to test what is the effect of microgravity on humans. So here's the space station today, a little bit beyond 2001, but it doesn't have that wheel shape at all. It's, but it does have something sort of missing in the Stanley Kubrick Arthur C. Clarke version. I'm sort of curious, what the heck is the power system for that spacecraft? Is that powered by batteries? Because I certainly don't see any an extension cord. And the most visible thing when you look at the space station is the solar arrays. In this particular case, we're looking at the backside, the yellow side of the solar arrays. But so I'm running out of time here, but I would like to mention that in my spare time, I'm also a science fiction writer. If you're interested in some of my books, here's a view of two of my books, Impact Parameter and Mars Crossing. So, thank you.
And that Mars Crossing, by the way, is the one that's out there for sale with our Barnes & Noble's reps. Thank you so much. I love how you put it was a conversation between science and science fiction. It's a very insightful way of putting it. So we're lucky enough to have one final performance from the Bach and Beethoven ensemble tonight. So please join me in welcoming back Catherine and Charlie, please.
The final piece that we will be performing tonight is a little aria from Il Mondo della Luna by Haydn, an opera by Haydn, The World of the Moon. It's actually a funny opera. And in this little aria, the character is actually the tenor. This is one of the opening arias in the piece. Eclitico is the tenor's name. He's kind of a phony astronomer. And he uses his hobby knowledge or lack of knowledge to trick the father of the girl that he loves throughout the opera, and kind of gets him in lots of fun situations and everything like that. But in this particular song, he's singing kind of a little ode to the moon. Oh, shining moon, Luna is moon in Italian. Shining moon, you're beautiful, your splendor up there, asking the moon to make yourself known to us, his friends, his students there, and show yourself to us, tell us what you are. So this is O Luna Lucente.
Thank you.
We close out this evening with a real treat. It's an honor to be joined by Joseph Bruchek, a writer and traditional storyteller whose work often reflects his American Indian Abenaki ancestry and the teachings passed on to him over the last half century by many Native elders. As the author of over 130 books for young and adult readers, his most popular titles include 13 Moons on Turtle's Back, The Girl Who Married the Moon, Keepers of the Earth, Between Earth and Sky, and Code Talker. You might especially know this latter book as the inspiration for the movie starring Nicolas Cage about the use of the Navajo language during World War II as a way to speak in a code that the Japanese were never able to break. I once saw Joe being interviewed about that book, saying that his real inspiration was to write a book about a native language surviving against all odds, and that, quote, although this might be described as a book about war, I tried very hard neither to glorify war nor demonize the enemy, but to see it all through Indian eyes, which is a very different way of seeing. A way of seeing how violence injures the spirit. This same care, a mixture of the talents of an artist, an historian, and someone who thinks deeply about the ethical meaning of his art and his history, is on display in all of Joe's writing and all of his work, as you will surely see for yourself. With his presentation entitled Nokomis, Our Grandmother the Moon, it's our good fortune to welcome Joseph Bruchek.
One of the ways that we traditionally begin a gathering is to acknowledge all those gifts of life that, quite frankly, we often forget to notice. We begin by acknowledging our mother, this earth, the one who gives life to all of us. We continue by acknowledging the waters of the earth, like the blood that flows through our veins. We acknowledge those plants that rise up from that soil. We acknowledge the animals, the birds, the winds themselves, the stones of the earth, which are, in our traditions, not dead, not insensitive, but as alive as we are. And we acknowledge what is above us in the sky. We see the great sun, who gives warmth and light to all things. We see those distant stars, the Watwisulk, the far above ones, as we call them. We also see, in the night, Nokomis, the grandmother, the moon. It is often said that the moon indeed is a grandmother, that her face shines down upon us, reminding us that even in the darkness, we are never alone. That whether it is night or day, we are always being observed. It reminds us that although the moon may seem to disappear, it is always there and returns constantly in a never-ending cycle. That cycle of which we are a part. For we, like the moon, the stars, and the sun, go through a cycle where all things are connected. Within our native traditions, it is commonly seen that cycle through light and dark, and also through the change of seasons and the cycles of the moon, which were closely observed by all our traditional cultures. It is no accident that various forms of observing the sky were done through things like the wood engines that were constructed in some places across the continent, that stones were set up in a certain way that light would fall at certain times to show the change of position of the sky, of the sun, and the seasonal changes that went with that. We say there are 13 moons, 13 moon cycles. And we say this is something so obvious because it is reflected by the turtle itself. If you look on the back of the turtle shell, it always has 13 plates, whether it's Africa, or the Caribbean, or the Pacific Islands. Wherever I've traveled in the world, turtles always have those 13 plates on them. The turtle I picked up yesterday at noon and rescued from the road as it was following that ancient trail that its ancestors followed to reach the place where eggs would be laid and the cycle would continue again. We say, in fact, that the earth is balanced on the back of a great turtle, which is an interesting concept because, of course, now that we know with plate tectonic theory, there is something beneath the seemingly solid surface of this planet. We say that when there are earthquakes and when there are flows of lava, when things happen and the ground begins to move with this turtle stretching her limbs. Those 13 moons were named differently according to the different tribal nations and what they observed in the world around them. For example, this time of year might be called, this moon might be called Kikaskisos, the moon when we begin to plant. The moon before this, where we are in the northeast in my homeland of Ndakina, our land that you know as New England or the northeast, we call the moon of March and February to March. Sogalikaskisos, which is the moon of flowing, the moon of maple syrup, which is gift given by the trees. In our old, old stories, we talk about the creation of the earth and how the moon came to be. My ancestors are on one side of my family from Europe, from Slovakia. On the other side, from the native peoples of this continent, predominantly Abenaki, but also Lenape and Mohawk, Haudenosaunee, or Iroquois. The story that is told among the Haudenosaunee is that long ago, there was only water here. There was no land. And high above in the skyline, there were beings living there. And the wife of the chief of the skyland had a dream. Her dream was a powerful one. In fact, we always say that it is the women who guide us and remind us what we need to know. Among the Haudenosaunee, in fact, the women have always traditionally chosen the leaders. And if the leaders do not behave, the women take them out of office. It has been said that American democracy owes a great deal of its structure to the League of the Haudenosaunee or Iroquois, except my Iroquois friends often said that they got several things wrong. One is they forgot that women are the ones who choose the leaders. It took a long time for women to be allowed to vote. A strange thing. In fact, a friend of mine, an elder of the Onondaga Nation named Dewasenta, some years ago when they were talking about the Equal Rights Amendment, I asked her what she thought of it, and she said, "I don't know if I'm for it." I said, "Why?" She said, "Well, no matter how many laws you pass, you'll never make a man equal to a woman." But in that story, the dream the Scott woman had was that the great tree in the skyline would be uprooted. When that tree was uprooted, there was a hole in the skyline. And Sky Woman fell through that hole. Some say she leaped, some say she slipped. As she fell, she stripped in her hand some of the seeds from that sky tree and fell down towards the waters below. Seeing her coming, those water creatures who lived there before human beings decided to help her. And swans and geese flew up and caught her on their backs and brought her down toward that water. And then, because there was no earth to stand on, the water creatures began to dive down to bring up soil to be put somewhere. Where? That is when the turtle put it to the surface and said, put it on my back. That turtle, whose shell is a reflection of the cosmos itself, and who holds up this earth where we stand. Sky Woman had a baby. She was pregnant when she fell. The first child born was a woman. Another reason for the importance of women in our culture, we say the women came first. And she herself, that child who was born, became pregnant by, some say, by the west wind, and had twin sons. One whose mind was good, one whose mind was twisted. Like all of us human beings, we can be in the good mind or in the twisted mind. We can be selfish. We can be self-aggrandizing. We can be we can be the opposite of what we should be. Or we can find the good mind and be in balance. But when she gave birth, the good mind twin was born in the proper way, and the one we call Flint, or the twisted mind, thrust out through the side of Sky Woman, killing her. And she was buried there, in that soil of this new earth. And from her grew the plants that provide life, the corn, the beans, and the squash. And it is said that her face was placed in the sky and became the moon, that she gave us that light in the darkness. There are so many stories of the moon. There is one story that comes from the traditions of the Mi'kmaq, the people you sometimes might call the Mi'kmaq, one of our native nations of the northeastern woodlands. Among those people who are a speaker of the Wabanaki language that I speak, just a slightly different dialect, they say that long ago, Rabbit was a great trapper. But one day he discovered that his traps had been looted. Someone had come and taken whatever he had caught in his traps, and he didn't know what it was. But he saw strange tracks, so he set up a snare to catch the one who had been taking what he had caught from his snares, and the snare caught someone who was very bright, so bright that Rabbit could barely look at that one. In fact, he began to throw water and clay at that one to try to lessen the brightness, but it would not lessen, and that's when he realized he had trapped the moon. And he had to release the moon to go back into the sky. But ever since then, they say moon has those pieces of clay stuck to it, making those marks on its face. Some say that the shape in the moon is not a man in the moon at all, but one of the animals. Rabbit often turns up as being the one in the moon, and if you look at the moon, you can see a rabbit there, perhaps as well as you can see a human face. Because the animals and the people are so connected, often we have stories that connect us to the moon through the animal people. One story is that one which is told actually among the people of the Northwest, among the Nisqually and other tribal nations, is that there was no moon in the sky. So someone had to volunteer to be the moon among the animals. And it was Yellow Fox who volunteered to do that and went up into the sky. But Yellow Fox was so bright that it hurt the people's eyes at night. So someone else had to be the moon. And that is when Coyote said, I will do it. I'll be glad to be the moon. And so indeed, Coyote became the moon. And for a while it was good. His light was not too bright, just enough for people to see a bit at night. But the problem was that Coyote can't leave well enough alone. He began to call down to the people while he was saying, hey, guess what? I saw someone was someone else's wife. Hey, that was very interesting. Would you like to know who it was? Hey, I saw someone taking salmon from someone else's fish trap. I can tell you who it was. Coyote was such a busybody that they had to take him out of the sky, turn someone else into the moon. All of these stories that we tell relate us to that great circle of life. which the moon gives us at night. It is also an inspiration of emotion. I began by playing the flute, and the flute has a place connected to the moon because, you see, we say that long ago, and I'll tell you a very quick version of this story, and this is a story from the Abenaki people, my own tribal nation. There was a young man who was a really good hunter and really generous of spirit and good looking, and everybody liked him, but he had one big problem. He was very shy among women. He could not speak. He became tongue-tied, especially when this one young woman he liked very much would walk by. He would say to himself, "Today, I'm going to tell her that she really looks good." She would walk by and he would go, She would say, "Oh, he's good looking, he's generous, he's handsome, indeed, but why is he always saying, when I see him? I don't understand those words." So that young man went to the wisest person he knew. He went to his grandmother and said, "Grandmother, I have a problem." And she said, "Well, I know you do, grandson. What can I do?" She said to him, "Go into Kitsikapiwi, the big forest, and listen, and you may find an answer there." So that young man went into the forest and sat under an old cedar tree and listened. And he began to hear a sound, something like this. When he looked up, he saw that one of the dead branches on that tree that was broken off at the end had holes that were put in it by a woodpecker, and the wind blowing over that branch made that sound. And somehow he got the idea that he could turn that branch into a musical instrument. He could blow into it and make a sound, because even though he was tongue-tied, he could still breathe a little bit when he saw that young woman. And he could make a song, and maybe she would understand what was in his heart. So he took that branch from the tree and gave thanks to the tree and to the woodpecker that made those holes and to the wind itself. And he fastened a piece of wood on top. In many cases, it's in the shape of a bird. To remember that woodpecker. He began to practice on that flute until he thought he was good enough. And then he waited until the full moon was in the sky. For it was understood that under the light of that moon, you could express things in a way that would reach someone else's heart. And he went behind that young woman's lodge where she lived with her parents, and he played the song he had composed for her. Inside that lodge heard that music and somehow understood it was for her and who was playing, and then she sort of said, "Finally, at last." She wanted to go out and speak to him, but it was late at night, and she had been told by her parents, really, do not go out at night because there may be danger out there. They have a really good reason to go out in the darkness. And so she looked around for a really good reason and saw the water pot and poured all the water out of it, held it up and said, "Mother, look, the water is all gone from the pot. I've got to go to the spring now." Her father said, "My daughter, why do you have to go outside and go to the spring in the middle of the night?" And her mother said, "My husband, you understand nothing, let our daughter go outside." That young woman went outside, she walked outside there. And that young man stood there, the moonlight shining down on him. She walked up to him, she said, "Was that song for me?" And he said, "Uh-huh." By the way, that's how you say yes in Abenaki, "uh-huh." And so they got to know each other, and eventually they married. And that song that he played for her, she composed words to it. And it became a lullaby sung for their children the night the grandmother moon shone down. The light of their love was now the light of the love for their children. That is how that story goes.
That is all I want to share with you for now. Thank you for this.
Thank you so much. I think because of the lateness of the hour, actually, what we'll do is we were going to take everybody out now to the telescopes, and I want to thank Tony Harris and the members of the Chicago Astronomical Society, but because we have not had cooperating weather, it's completely cloud-covered outside, so we won't be able to take that visit together. But we hope that the clouds will part and you'll be able to see the full moon tonight that brought us together. And also, I'd like to invite you all to stay around and keep the conversation going for a while. We have the room for a bit with all of our speakers and our presenters as well tonight. And to join me once again in thanking them and thanking all of you for coming out. Good night to you, good night to our speakers and presenters, and good night, Moon. Thanks so much for being here tonight.